Headaches are among the most common reasons why patients seek medical attention. A common misconception is that people think it is their brain that hurts. This is actually not true. The brain tissue doesn't have pain-sensitive nerve fibers and doesn't feel pain. So what could be responsible for a headache? A network of nerves that extends over the scalp. Certain nerves in the face, mouth, and throat. Muscles of the head, neck, and shoulders. Blood vessels found along the surface and at the base of the brain. It is relatively rare for a headache to be life-threatening, but it is very important to recognize and properly manage such patients. We divide headaches into primary and secondary headaches. Migraine, tension type, and cluster headaches are responsible for up to 90% of primary headaches. Primary headaches have no known underlying cause. TTH is the most common headache and common neurological disorder in the community. When you have a typical TTH attack, you usually feel a mild or moderate, non-throbbing pain on both sides of your head. Rarely, however, episodes of TTH may be unilateral, severe, or throbbing. Patients may describe TTH pain as like a tight band around my head or like a heavy weight on my head and shoulders. Tenderness in the head, neck, and shoulders, typically exacerbated during headache, is the most important abnormal finding seen in patients with TTH. We do not know the exact pathogenesis of TTH. Multiple factors are probably involved. Increased sensitivity of pain pathways in the central nervous system and perhaps in the peripheral nervous system is thought to play a critical role in the pathogenesis of TTH. Classification of TTH is important because it determines treatment. Infrequent episodic TTH with headache attacks less than 1 day per month. Frequent episodic TTH, headache attacks 1 to 14 days per month. Chronic TTH, headache 15 or more days per month. Emotional stress is the most important trigger factor. Migraine and tension headache symptoms can overlap and it is difficult to distinguish between the conditions. Simple analgesics and nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are the first choices for acute treatment. Caffeine-containing combination analgesics are a second-line option. Precautions should be taken to avoid headaches due to excessive drug use. Opioids and skeletal muscle relaxants are not usually used to treat tension-type headache. Prophylactic treatment is considered if acute treatments are ineffective or if the patient has chronic tension headache. We should consider non-pharmacological treatment for all patients. Electromyography biofeedback is helpful. Acupuncture, physical therapy, relaxation training can be options, but there is no solid evidence that they work. The first-line drug treatment for prophylaxis is amitriptyline. Migraine is an episodic disease characterized by a severe headache, usually accompanied by nausea and/or sensitivity to light and sound. Migraine affects 12 to 15% of the general population and is more common in women. Migraine pain can make you unable to do your daily work. A typical migraine attack has three phases: prodrome, headache, postdrome. About a quarter of migraine patients also experience a fourth phase called aura. 77% of migraine patients experience a prodrome period that begins 1 or 2 days before the onset of the headache. During this period, symptoms such as irritability, food cravings, constipation, increased yawning, and depression may be prominent. About 1 in 4 people with migraine experience one or more focal neurological symptoms in the second stage, called migraine aura. These symptoms may precede or accompany the headache. So what does migraine aura mean? You can see the aura as a group of symptoms that act like warning signals that a migraine headache is about to start. Auras are usually visual but can also be sensory, verbal, or motor disturbances. We see that migraine auras usually develop gradually over a period of more than 5 minutes and last no more than an hour. However, auras can rarely develop more rapidly. Aura can be confused with transient ischemic attack or stroke when it starts acutely. Some patients may have isolated auras without headache. We can describe migraine pain as moderate to severe. Attacks can last between 4 and 72 hours. It typically increases with physical activity. The headache is typically unilateral, but this is not always the case. The pain tends to become pulsatile or throbbing as it intensifies. During attacks, most patients experience nausea and may even vomit. Many people experience photophobia, which means sensitivity to light, and phonophobia, which means sensitivity to sound. After the headache subsides, patients may experience a post-drome period, during which they often feel exhausted, but some feel a mild elation. During migraine attacks, actions such as touching the scalp and shaving can cause pain called cutaneous allodynia. Cutaneous allodynia is the perception of pain caused by harmless stimulation of otherwise normal skin. Emotional stress, hormonal fluctuations, not eating, weather, and many other factors can be triggers. There are different types of migraine, which we will not go into detail here. Patients' medical history, the severity of their attacks, pregnancy, or breastfeeding may change the treatment. For patients presenting with significant nausea or vomiting, a non-oral agent may be preferred. Our aim in acute treatment is to relieve pain by minimizing side effects. Simple analgesics are recommended for mild to moderate migraine attacks. Triptans are recommended for moderate to severe migraine attacks. Alternative options include CGRP antagonists, lasmiditan, antiemetic drugs, and dihydroergotamine. Evidence for non-pharmacological methods such as cold neck wraps, acupuncture, oxygen therapy is limited. The aim of prophylactic treatments is to reduce the frequency and severity of migraine, improve response to acute treatment, and reduce the risk of neurological deterioration. Cluster headaches associated with trigeminal autonomic cephalalgias, a group of idiopathic headache disorders, are relatively rare and can be very severe. The lifetime prevalence of cluster headache, which mostly affects men, is about 0.1%. Cluster headache is associated with tobacco use and head trauma and seems to have a genetic component in some families. Cluster headaches are of a very severe nature, and depression is very common among people suffering from this condition. Patients may describe these headaches as like being stabbed with a knife. It is usually at maximum intensity during an attack and then ends abruptly. Patients are typically restless and prefer to rock back and forth or pacing during attacks. Symptoms occur mostly in the periorbital and temporal region. Cluster headache attacks are unilateral. In the majority of cases, the symptoms remain on the same side of the head, but in some cases they may move to the other side during a different cluster attack. Typical attacks can occur once every other day to up to 8 times a day. Attacks tend to occur at the same time each time. A typical attack starts quickly, lasting from 15 minutes to 3 hours. Autonomic symptoms typically only occur during an acute attack and are on the same side as the pain. In rare cases, in patients whose cluster headache changes sides, sympathetic disorders persist on the previously affected side of the face. About 3% of patients with cluster headache do not have autonomic symptoms. Diagnostic criteria for episodic cluster headache require: attacks that meet the criteria for cluster headache and occur in seizures. At least 2 cluster periods lasting 7 days to 1 year, when untreated, separated by periods of painless remission lasting 3 months or more. Diagnostic criteria for chronic cluster headache require the following: attacks meeting the criteria for cluster headache. Attacks occurring without a remission period for at least 1 year or with remissions lasting less than 3 months. Chronic cluster headache can be new onset or evolve from the episodic type. It can also evolve into the episodic type itself. Initial treatment with oxygen or triptans is recommended for patients with acute cluster headache. Verapamil is the agent of choice for initial preventive treatment in most patients with cluster headache. Glucocorticoids can also be used alone as preventive therapy when cluster attacks are infrequent and of short duration. The frequency of seizures and attacks may decrease with advancing age. 25% of patients will have only one attack in their lifetime. A headache caused by an underlying condition is termed a secondary headache. SNNOP-10 criteria may be helpful in identifying red flags suggestive of a secondary cause of headache. Systemic symptoms including fever, neoplasm in history, neurologic deficit. Onset of headache is sudden or abrupt. Older age. Pattern change or recent onset of headache. Positional headache. Precipitated by sneezing, coughing, or exercise. Papilledema. Progressive headache and atypical presentations. Pregnancy or puerperium. Painful eye with autonomic features. post-traumatic onset of headache. Pathology of immune system, such as with HIV infection. Painkiller overuse or use of new drug at onset of headache.